The President. Dr. Chang Chung-tai, thank you. In relation to the budget this year, we are in the final stage of our debate. Let me state clearly my position. In general terms, of course, I oppose the budget. I hope you will understand. For this budget, well, it was delivered against a background of political turbulence. The government didn't make it clear, but I'm sure the people of Hong Kong are clear about the nature of the budget. In fact, it is a matter of a budget of a transitional government. What do I mean by that? Well, if you recall, for the past few years, whenever I commented the policy address or the budget, I always emphasized the following point. Since 1997, the Hong Kong government has always appeared to be a watchover government. Maybe up to 2047, when we supposed to have the basic law until that particular year, and then that will be the end of it. Now, last year, we started the anti-extradition bill protest. Therefore, for this budget, it isn't just a budget of a watchover government. It is also a budget for the sake of transfer of power or that of a transitional government. So we should not have any expectations at all. Do you get my point? This is all because the purpose is to make sure that within the government and within the establishment camp and in the society as a whole, the budget will not be met with too much opposition and there will not be too much reaction. And then it would have its purpose would have been achieved. Do you recall that in February when the FS talked about the budget, he was rather happy, and he has been sort of telling us about the handing out of the $10,000 cash. And on that day, Paul Chen and Edward Yao almost called a press conference at around the same time as the CE, Carrie Lam. Therefore, I would say that for the budget that we are debating, it is a matter for the transition of power from CE's or Carrie Lam's administration. But then in March, the CE didn't step down. In April, Carrie Lam didn't step down. Now we are in May and she still hasn't stepped down. So in relation to the shakeup, I think things are getting more and more complicated. There has been overhaul. In other words, the budget hasn't achieved the basic purpose of a transition of power. Maybe you don't understand what I'm driving at. Well, the purpose of handing out $10,000 is to make sure that irrespective of the political background, we are having a universal cash handout so that we can sort of wipe out the history of what happened last year so that everybody will be encouraged to forget what happened. Nobody has ever imagined that for as short as 3 months' time, the landscape, both in Hong Kong and in the world as a whole, have undergone so many changes. Mr. Chairman, I have to sort of elaborate on my point. Why I say that it is a transitional government's budget. I think the purpose is to ease the pain while we approach our death. Maybe you don't agree with me, but still I have to emphasize that every year I try to forecast what is going to happen in the coming year. I'm not supposed to be a prophet. Last year, around this time, I talked about the US-China trade war. Today, at this moment, I will urge everybody to be clear-headed. I don't think public officers here nor lawmakers, including myself, can cope with the emerging situation. Police brutality, cash handout of $10,000, among others, have been mentioned by members in this budget. I talked about the drug trafficking committed by policemen last week when I spoke. For this budget, it is supposed to address the issues arising from the collapse of the social, economic, political system. Our public officers don't understand what actually is meant by power. I'm saying that the political landscape is crumbling. Well, last year we had the protests. The biggest shock wasn't so much brought about by the vandalism, but rather the internal strife within the establishment camp. I think we're still having it today. Junius Ho, do you understand? The Executive Council has failed in its functions. It was shocking to see that for 2 weeks, the Executive Council didn't meet. So I don't have to talk about how rotten the political system was like. In January, Huang Zhengming. In February, Zhang Xiaoming stepped down. Hulun Chao, you don't have to look in my direction. I think it's your turn. You may stand as a candidate in the upcoming election. And then Junius Ho, I think you have a share, but you will not get elected. Please don't try to consider running in the DC constituency and try to come back to the electoral. No, you won't have the chance. Now, the budget has failed totally in addressing the economic issues. So again, it has failed us. From 2003 up to now, we have always thought that our prosperity will be long-lasting. Now the bubble has been pierced once and for all. Well, in terms of our budgetary discipline, in terms of our economic structure, I think we do have a lot of problems. Our economic structure is too one-sided in terms of nurturing of talents, management skills, management knowledge, legacy, etc. Well, in the year 2003, when we had SARS outbreak, and that marks the first 5 years of Hong Kong, we spent 5 years to get a dose of morphine in the form of individual visa schemes. At first, we thought that our economy was rejuvenated. I believe I belong to that generation. I went to Beijing University. I thought I would learn a lot there. So on the one hand, we will be selling the goods from China, and then we'll go to the mainland to learn. So we thought we will be sort of in the middle ground, and we'll stand to gain when China is going out. So we thought we were able to benefit in the second 5 year period, a golden period. But then, of course, you will understand that we were surprised to learn that livelihood issues, like economic structures. Please come back to the budget. I'm on the budget. You think I'm not? This year's budget, please, Dr. Chang. Well, I would be more concrete in my speech. Well, the economy has come to a standstill. The whole world is in lockdown. So had I been the designer of this budget, I would have done the following. Two departments have to be reformed. First, the police force. Second, the hospital authority. This is all because the two of them are supporting our political as well as the economic setup. We've only got these two departments that are still doing work. Forget about all other departments. Development Bureau, Land Out Tomorrow Vision, nobody would believe in that. Innovation technology, if you talk about innovation technology, don't you think that it is laughable to apply innovation technology to use a thermal device to control mice? Well, you have got a mismatch of resources and roles when the Health Bureau doesn't hand out the masks but leave it in the hands of the Innovation Technology Bureau. Now, the police force and the hospital authority are such that by having a reallocation of resources and by working via the economic means, we try to strike a balance. I'm not sure whether you understand what I mean. First of all, our government can only rely on the police force to adopt a suppressive approach to maintain law and order here. Please don't be looking at the superficial issues only. I think there are lots of loopholes. Of course, there has been a public outcry to spend $1 billion to pay for the overtime worked. But then those at the senior level won't have a share in the overtime payment. Only the police constables, police sergeants, etc. can claim OT allowance. They used to get $50,000 a month. With OT, it means that they are getting $100,000 a month, earning more than the senior inspectors. Come back to the debate, please. I'm on the budget. There are bugs in the system, and therefore the police force is corrupt. This is because you need to give them ancillary power so that they can go around to beat people up. So those at the front line get overtime allowance. For those in the middle and those in higher up the scale, they don't get any allowance. So maybe we go back to the days when we used to have Mr. Wa, the famous head of the detective force. Well, when we talk about overhauling the police force, isn't so much about eliminating police brutality. But, of course, I would say that the executive no longer plays any meaningful role. The political powers are being propped up by the police force. But then, unfortunately, there are bugs within the power structure of the police force. So let them have more manpower, let them have more resources, but then the end result would be making it even more flawed, and then the balance will be lost. So if you don't understand the political and setup and the power distribution, then it will be very bad. Now, I turn to the hospital authority. We have this pandemic when it comes to social security and our healthcare system. We used to have confidence. Now, as a result of the political turbulence, the hospital authority must suppress those doctors and healthcare professionals who have made known their political inclination. And therefore, the aristocracy in the healthcare system will be sort of monopolizing the system. So we've only got the following left: the police force, as well as doctors and healthcare managers who are pro-government. And then the end result is that that would spell the end of Hong Kong. And therefore, I'm going to oppose the budget. And I come to my final word. Priscilla Leung and other pandems talked about the book, The Search of Modern China. Please read the book first before you will have any other comments in relation to the book by Mr. John Spence.
Mr. Holden Chow. Chairman, on this appropriation bill, well, I have to raise a very major demands. The $10,000 can help must be dispersed as soon as possible. According to the timetable that we disperse the open application by late June is too late. You could make use of the citizens' information on the social welfare system as they're already on allowances or a social welfare payment. So why couldn't you credit that to their account right away? That would save a lot of work. So that's the first demand. Second, while the anti-epidemic fund, ready for the 1.0 or 2.0, they provide some support which benefits some, and there are some that are still left out. We request the government to provide unemployment assistance so it can able to preserve the jobs, because the freelancers are not able to benefit in the first two rounds of the AEF. That the unemployment assistance could directly tackle that. And third request will be on the loopholes of the employment support scheme. Len Chicheng and I have received complaints from the landowners in new territories that the owners cooperated would have paid the management fees on behalf of the homeowners, and they were, which they in turn would pay for the security guards. And there have not been any pay cut. However, the management company could apply for the ESS for the $9,000. So the money would be pocketed by the management companies. However, the homeowners could not get any subsidy. So that's not fair to them. The government should plug this loophole. Though to qualify for the subsidy, you should pass on to the homeowners instead of the management company. Or shouldn't the management company should pay the subsidy back to the homeowners? Of course, we'd ensure the security guards would not be affected in their pay. The government should definitely plug this loophole. For this appropriation bill, we hope that it could be passed as soon as possible. And for the various relief measures and for the cash handout scheme, we hope that money could arrive as soon as possible. We support the appropriation bill. That doesn't mean that we see that a lot of government departments have come to our satisfaction. Well, in the following time, I would like to make specific requests for the government departments. I hope that the public officers could respond. First, for the EDB. Today we have seen another episode. The senior member of the HKEAA had openly made remarks in hiding hatred towards the police, or even instruct people that if there's no Japanese invasion of China, there will be no new China, to glorify the Japanese atrocities in World War II, and also see something with sexual connotations. If the HKEA, being the responsible for making exam papers and marking them, and yet its board members have made such remarks, where is the professionalism? Well, if the test paper is actually approved by these kind of people, is that telling the students to succumb to them, that you must follow their weight and accept the fallacies in order to survive? The HKEAA, well, Mr. Chow, in this session, will allow you to speak whether you support or object to this appropriation bill. Please return to this. I got it. Well, Speaking of supporting this bill, however, I would like to make some requests associated with them. The EDB should know that it has to set up a sanction mechanism for the unethical teachers, the method way of handling. Today, Mr. Yip Kin Yun simply looked the other way. However, it is simply condoning the teachers into misleading the young generations. We need to establish a clear penalty mechanism when to be interdicted and when we disqualified these teachers. And we need to have supervised its curriculum. The EDB should assume its proper role. After the passage of the appropriation bill, I hope that we heard from the public office's response on how do we follow up on this kind of situation so as no longer condone unethical teachers and the poisoning of young generation. Well, these are the hidden dirt that must be cleared. Another department I want to highlight. I'll make a specific request will be the Department of Justice. In this bill, we demanded that they assign additional manpower to prosecute the black-clad violence cases because we have a huge backlog and have a large number of unprosecuted cases. The DOJ has a duty to assign more manpower to stringently prosecute the black-clads. While there's one thing for prosecution, also need to review the sentencing. Well, it's some recent rulings. The sentencing were too light. This gives the impression that we are condoning or encouraging violence without any cost. So the DOJ makes sure they can review the sentencing. That's the only way that we can put things right. The DOJ must uphold this duty. I would like to get a response for the public officers and some elaboration. And in this appropriation bill, the mutual destruction camp would target the police expenditure. All along, they claim they would like to target police expenditure because they disagree with their proposed spending or even would like to bring the whole budget down with it. They showed that for political gain, that result of their old tactic. Most recently, for the police, you have some cases of infringement for the so-called fake reporters. In a Facebook Live, I'm using some lewd comments on a female police officer. Well, the whole thing is very hooliganish and also cause a public backlash. Well, the DOJ should rigorously pursue that because there was a suspect criminal offense and also a crime against public order and decency and should be rigorously pursued. I could see the mutual destruction camp, the target police and the inside police hatred will fan out to all corners and even the fake reporters at the scene will continue to magnify such acts. And that's hugely detrimental to our society. Well, if the Scorch M camp keeps stressing of the need to cut police expenditure, if you cut the whole police budget and please don't call the police, it would get into trouble. If you claim that you shouldn't give a penny to the police and so they will not operate, well, if anything happened, you shouldn't ask the police for help. Let's make it clear. And please don't call in trouble. Please don't get police help, we'll get in trouble, but while cutting their budget if we don't need them. That's just double standard. In this bill, while this epidemic is still whiplashing the economy, we hope that the money could arrive to the public as soon as possible. We don't want to see any ecological destruction occurring in this chamber and in society. If those insist to scorch earth at this stage, that is a purely selfish proposition in order to achieve their own political aims while disregarding their public livelihood. Unfortunately, we see that this scorched earth camp was simply manifesting this selfishness. Thus, we have the duty to point out and expose their hypocrisy, and also remind the government that upon the passage of the appropriation bill, I hope you can make a clear undertaking on how do we address our demands, including the disperse the $10,000 at early opportunity to benefit the public. I so submit.
I train you.
Mr. Tony J. Thank you, Chairman. Chairman, the Appropriation Bill 2020, we're dealing with clauses 1 and 2, and also the third reading. I'd like to state my position regarding the voting and also my rationale. As I pointed out earlier on, in order to alleviate the burden on different sectors arising from the new novel coronavirus, the FS, Mr. Paul Chen, has rolled out relief measures totaling $120 billion. And we're going to see a deficit of $140 billion. And these numbers are the highest ever in Hong Kong's history. The pandemic is raging across the world. The US, Europe, Japan, and many of the economic giants are experiencing outbreaks, and the impact on the economy would be far greater than it was when the budget was delivered. And it was far worse than what was forecast in the budget. Chairman, as you understand, just last week, the quarterly GDP has dropped by a whopping 8.9%. This is the worst since the record began in 1960s. In response to members during the second reading debate, the FS said that the economic growth forecast will be adjusted downward to -4 to -7%. And in the light of the latest development, the administration rolled out the second tranche of anti-COVID fund to the tune of $137.5 billion, and the employers are funded in making pay to the office to the workers, and there will be 30,000 jobs to be created. And all these are necessary, and I don't think we will be able to get rid of all the impacts. And these would make the government suffer in the coffers. The deficit this year is going to be higher than the forecast. The Appropriation Bill 2020, a lot of the revenue and expenditure forecasts would have been overtaken by events. In terms of estimates, the previous and existing financial secretaries did get the forecast wrong. Instead of billions dollars of deficit, we ended up with billions and billions of surplus. But this is not a problem of the financial secretary getting some wrong, and I don't think we should object to the third reading of the debate because of this reason. The Burn With Us camp members are not happy with the policing. They're not happy with individual bureaus and departments or individual officials. and they would like to bring down the whole budget with them, and they want to bring the government to its knees and grind all the services to a halt. They're trying to cut the pay off the police officers. Is this a legitimate move? I don't think I can subscribe to this notion. They are going after the police. Without the police, it would be the quibble elements that would stand to benefit. It would be those who want to have their own say who would benefit from it. Now, when I look at the budget, whether I should support it, in fact, I do have some displeasure with regard to the performance of some officials or some departments. If I may cite a couple of examples, take LWB, for instance. They do have the obligation to improve the labor rights and interests of the workers. But in their eyes, the workers are merely workers in the hierarchy. Do they include the middle-class people? Would the LWB feel that the labor rights of the middle-class people do not need any protection? Given the pandemic and the economic downturn, shouldn't they need any assistance from the government? I don't see anything, any considerations being given to the middle class and the professional people. Recently, they have done some tinkering around the edges, and they've made amends, and this is all a step in the right direction. At least, they're receptive to public opinions. Of course, a lot of members, the pro-establishment members who have been critical of the RTHK, like headliners, Pentaprism, and the World Health Organization incident, and there are some current affairs programs that are criticized for having biased position or preconceived positions. If anything, they are inciting hatred against the government, against the police, against the mainland of China, and also against the pro-establishment camp. Chairman, I'm not going to tar everybody with the same brush. Just because I don't like this, that doesn't mean I have to slash the budget of RTHK and bring down the whole budget. Just because I'm not happy with the employment protection scheme and some of the fine details of implementation doesn't mean that I'm going to be asking for Mr. Lo Chi Kwong, SLW's pay to be cut for the whole year. Chairman, with the concerted efforts, Hong Kong has gone 3 weeks without any locally transmitted cases in Hong Kong, but that 3-week streak has been broken. By comparison with other jurisdictions in the world, where they have tens of thousands of casualties and confirmed cases, head on heart, I think Hong Kong is not doing too badly. In Hong Kong, the greatest threat is the resurgence of the violent protesters and also the worsening ties between US and China. Even if we can rid ourselves of the pandemic, the situation will not change for the better immediately. There will continue to be upheavals in Hong Kong, so I would urge the FS to have regard to the situation. And in the light of the latest development globally, we should mobilize the hard-earned savings or the reserves that have been building up for so many years and roll out more relief measures. And more importantly, to get Hong Kong back up on its feet economically. With these words, I support the third reading of the Appropriation Bill 2020.
Mr. Vincent Cheng. Mr. Chairman, I speak in support of the question that is clauses 1 and 2 stand part of the bill. Later on, when the bill is to be read for the first time, I'm going to vote for it. Mr. Chairman, this is the third year that I take part in the budget debate. In general terms, I support the bill. I've put forward my arguments earlier on. I think our economy is in pretty bad shape. $120 billion are to be spent. Now, many people are still asking us as to when the $10,000 will reach their pockets. The government is paying a month's rent for the public rental housing, estate tenants, shops, and among other concessionary measures. They're good. There are also measures to support enterprises and safeguard jobs. They deserve our endorsement. There are areas of inadequacy. Say, for example, should the $10,000 be given to the public earlier so that we don't have to wait that long? More and more people are getting unemployed, and then we should reconsider the viability of having an unemployment benefit. So we need to take into account the prevailing circumstances and come up with ways to help the vulnerable. Well, for all the CSAs, I have already voted against the CSAs, and for the opposition camp, they are going to vote against the third reading of the bill. I have anticipated that. Now, in fact, since 1974, we have not had something as bad as what we got now. In fact, the FS said that we are in a deep recession. Many households have no income or less income. They have to struggle. The government's subsidy can't fully address their problems. It is indeed very, very difficult to go back to the labor force when you lose your job. Now, the opposition camp is still adamant in opposing the budget. 2 years ago, some opposition camp members might vote against the budget. Now, they are trying. They have become radicalized, and they don't care even if by vetoing the bill, people don't get the $10,000 cash handout. Now, we are worried that Black riots will erupt again. Last Sunday, we celebrated the Mother's Day. The prohibition on group gathering was eased so that people could gather in a group. People can go shop, could go shopping, could go having meals. Many said that they had refrained from meeting family members. They just talked on the phone. Now they were glad to see that they could come out to have meals together. But then what actually happened on the ground? They were singing with you among other protests. Now, someone may say that the police shouldn't intervene because the protesters were merely singing songs together. But look at what they did. It wasn't just singing. They vandalized the properties. They burned the litter bins. And then materials for manufacturing bombs, preparing petrol bombs, etc., were found on school campus. For the rioters, they won't let any opportunities go. They will try to spread hatred against the police. I think Hong Kong is being poisoned by such. I'm afraid what they're doing is not going to help. Many hotels and guest houses are having no income at all. I urge the FS to consider the following. Now, with the passage of the bill, I just wonder if the stimulating effect of the budget can really be that effective. FS, now we need to revitalize the economy after the epidemic has been brought under control. I don't know for how much longer we can hold out. Now, the black riots have affected our economy. And in fact, we have been affected by a lot of false information, and hate speech is still casting a cloud over our heads. Yesterday, the DAB released a document. Over 70% of those interviewed said that false news and also the rumors have radicalized the young people, and they have been encouraged to break the law. I'm bringing this in, and it's relevant because we may have a lot of measures to support enterprises and safeguard jobs, but if or as long as we have the vandalism and the riots, all the initiatives in the budget are not going to have any effective outcome. Now, a lot of members are saying that they're against paying the CE, paying the directors of bureaus. They want to cut the police expenditure. Well, in fact, it has become habitual for them to oppose the budget. The opposition camp would like to hold the CE to ransom by blocking the bill, hoping that she would step down. They admitted it on their own. They said that they would like to make good use of the power to veto the budget so that it will be a case of we burn, you burn with us. They accused the CE, Carrie Lam, for being the mother of the scorched earth policy. But in fact, on the contrary, it's only the opposition camp that's doing it. Benny Tai told us about the 10-step program. So he would like to have the majority in the LegCo, the budget will be vetoed, and then the CE will be forced to step down, and the central people's government will intervene. Everybody will take to the streets to protest, and then the Western powers can intervene and carry out sanctions. Outrageous. What sort of arguments? I think that's their political motive and objectives. What do they have to do with the budget? The budget is here to overcome the livelihood difficulties. And yet they're trying to use this as a means to achieve their political objective so that the Western powers will have an excuse to intervene and sanction Hong Kong. Well, we're having this constitutional crisis day in, day out. And the end result is that the government is in a shutdown and we don't have money to spend on welfare, education, etc. Don't forget that they had opposed the vote on account motion as well. I think when we have a crisis, we should set aside our political differences. We should say yes to the anti-epidemic fund 2.0. That's what have been expected of us. No, they won't follow that logic. They will just allow the political turbulence, they will allow the social disharmony to go on and on. Now, in the face of the COVID-19, our people are really good. They have a high sense of alertness. When we go out, we have formed a habit to put on a face mask. Some people have stayed away. They have stayed home for a month's time just to protect themselves and to protect others. In other countries, no, people just go out as usual. But this is not the case for Hong Kongers. Yesterday, a number of cases emerged, and we are worried about the future. We don't know how the outbreak would develop. We mustn't allow political differences to plague us. Even if we have a budget on a quarterly basis, even if we have the anti-epidemic fund 3.0, 4.0, 5.0, they are not going to help. I will certainly support the bill, Mr. Chairman. For the budget as well as the anti-epidemic fund, we are talking about giving out cash and providing resources. But I believe that more has to be done by way of the regulation. For guest houses in Yao Chim and Mong Kok, yes, they're getting a few dozens of thousands of dollars to help them to survive. But I don't think they're going to survive much longer. I think we need to deregulate the industry. Some guest house operators know that students are waiting for a place in the student hostels. Maybe the government can consider giving a subsidy to the students so that they can stay in guest houses temporarily. Tomorrow and next month, we are having the debate on the Ocean Park. I don't think we are getting visitors to come to Hong Kong. So even if we inject billions of dollars into the accounts of the Ocean Park, maybe it can't survive. Still, I hope that we can pass the bill ASAP to benefit the general public. Thank you.
Kent Leung. We're talking about the joint debate on the third session of the appropriation bill debate. I will not talk about the specifics because they have been repeat ad infinitum. Okay, let's. I pointed there are five blind spots that the budget failed to face. First, on the structural budget deficit. Well, that been mentioned quite a few years ago. However, the external environment and also the epidemic, this had become a self-fulfilling prophecy. I don't mean to scare everyone. The FS have failed to address the long-standing problem of structural deficit. In the 2014 government forecast, well, the 2041 financial forecast, a median age is 51 years old, and the dependency ratio that those over 65 compared to those 50 to 64 will shoot up to 49.7%. And this year, if we include this AEF 2.0, this year financial deficit, according to the FS own estimates, will be $276 billion. Which is about 10% of our GDP. Well, the estimate is flawed. Of course, we can round it up to, let's say, $300 billion. Let's say for 2022-2021, the budget deficit will be $300 billion. So what will happen in the next 2 to 3 years? We have a crystal ball to see how the future will play out. However, looking at the global pandemic situation and also the trade disputes, the multilateral trade dispute, and also the political tension. If there are about $100 billion deficit, it help our grassroots and help our companies. If we have a $100 billion deficit next 3 years ahead, they will talk about $600 billion. And our $1.1 trillion of reserves and minus $600 billion. What would our future look like? There's no mention of this in the appropriation bill. Another huge problem is that our recurrent expenditure has been growing at an uncontrolled pace. This year, our recurrent expenditure growth is understandable. Well, especially in times of downturn, the government boosting its recurrent expenditure is perfectly reasonable. Well, the past 2 decades, from 1997 to 2019, our recurrent expenditure growth rate had increased by cumulatively 195%. And our local GDP, the growth rate past 22 years cumulatively only 102%. The growth rate of the cumulative growth of the budget exceed that of our GDP. Well, that's unsustainable in the next 10 years. And yet, we never tried to tackle that. Of course, our education and healthcare and social welfare make a big chunk of this growth. However, in order to clamp down on these expenses that will not introduce policies that are hostile to the people, well, according to him, but we failed to explain the rationale. And yesterday, Standard & Poor's and rating agency claimed that Hong Kong is very likely to have a credit downgrade. Well, there are two other rating agencies as well besides S&P. But currently our rating is an AA+, which is quite nice as a municipal government. While the credit rating itself encompasses lots of factors, well, one factor will be the structural deficit, another one, the uncontrollable growth of the credit expenditure. If these two factors can be overcome, our credit ratings will not be such an issue. While the rating not only look into this, but other kind of risk factors. For example, our rule of law, our information freedom, our economic ties with the mainland, and whether our economy are being in lockstep with the mainland. If the mainland is going down, will our economy going down with it? Or we have a relatively independent market and supply chain. That's something the rating agencies would consider. Well, the FS Felton mentioned the credit agency expectation of our economy. If the agency cut down our sovereign rating, ready for a government to issue debt, and also the corporate debt will get more expensive. And also raise the question that whether the global investors are interested in our bond instrument as a whole. A fourth issue, basic but complicated. The government have took notice in the past 10 years that it touched on that we have a very narrow income base. For so many years, we relied on our direct tax receipts and also on land revenue, just as non-recurrent. So we have the salary tax, stamp duties, and profit tax. And however, all these three types of taxes in the face of economic downturn will be sharply reduced. Well, in a downward cycle, we actually need to boost our spending. Well, we lost our income and yet we need to spend more, so our coffers will be depleted. Well, for the stamp duty, and the other will come from property transactions and also from stock transactions. When there's a sharp drop in direct tax receipt, but at the same time, you need to spend more. What could a government do? You can't print money. With Hong Kong is such a small economy, you can't print money like the US does. And also in direct tax, we have very little income from that. Well, when the economy hitting rock bottom, this political suicide introduced new taxes and the government wouldn't do it. Well, at the time of economic boom, when the tax receipts is in plenty for government to come with a new tax or new wage revenue, it doesn't seem to match with time. When you're in good times, when you're proposing a new tax, well, the government should at the right time should actually bite the bullet. If you kick the can down the road, that are promoting stability and expanding our revenue base would continue to be a challenge. Besides having new indirect taxes, the government also failed to do its cost recovery. Of course, this year, let's say the company registry and lots of commercial services, the government had waived a lot of fees due to this extraordinary circumstances and may extend to next year. But in the long run, a cost recovery is something that the government must do so as to balance our books. We'll talk about introducing new taxes or to boost our tax receipts. Well, the tax policy autonomy have been greatly reduced in the past few years, and the financial secretary has spent quite a few paragraphs devoted on it. Well, the latest proposal was that the global lowest tax rate. I didn't get a chance to touch on that. That will lead to a sharp drop in our competitiveness, as we know that Hong Kong enjoyed a lower tax rate other than some Singapore companies that may have an even lower tax rate than us. On average, at 16.5% of profit tax, we're probably the lowest in the world. On the other hand, our actual tax rate is actually at 9%. Well, the OECD have persuaded the EU and the G20 that to attract the FDI through the low tax is not fair. We need to set up a global minimum tax rate, and so far the level is at 12.5%. Currently we are at 9%, within the actual rate in here. Does that mean we have to raise our taxes? And if we lost our tax autonomy, well, in the long run, how will our competitiveness fare? Well, I heard from the FS that he claimed that he will get to it. Well, as such a small economy, how could we haggle with the OECD and the G20 group? That's a huge problem, and there has been a long-standing problem that yet to be resolved. The fifth point. Well, let's call it a public finance questions, and also the supervision of arbitrage activities. In the past 2 months, after the FS revealed the budget, we see a huge phenomenon. Most recently, well, some claimed that the mailing company listed in Hong Kong, some of those may forsake Hong Kong and return to Shanghai as their main listing market. Well, they may need to dovetail with the national policy, which will cost us some market share. There are also some news development that some of those Chinese-owned companies listing in NYSE and NASDAQ, like JD.com, may make a second listing in Hong Kong. I don't know the reason. Maybe the supervisory regime is more appropriate for those kind of companies. Well, according to some conspiracy theory, is that because our supervision system being more flexible? I see one worrying trend, that the CEO of the SFC will be replaced. Well, Mr. Ashley Alder, well, his tech supervision has been on the strict side. Well, it would be different from the HAA's handling of the listing applications. Well, as a stock market would also help this company to get listed in Hong Kong, even though they wear another hat as a regulator. In the long run, HKEX or Hong Kong as a whole has become a place for regulatory arbitrage. The Hong Kong global, what would the global investors see in Hong Kong? Let's say of the US or the UK, the regulation get too strict. Why? Well, we should go to Hong Kong because it's a huge market with abundant capital, and we get listed in Hong Kong. Would that be better? Well, in terms of the future developments in the budget or where the next step, next phase for our capital markets, there's no mention of it. The government should think that to tackle about the regulatory arbitrage, not only a capital markets problem, or maybe our insurance sector may also have this problem of regulatory arbitrage, or the five problems, for example, on a structural deficit, a narrowed revenue base, we're not resolved, or we have no solutions. Our credit rating will naturally be downgraded. Our rating will not only look at our financials, our income, and our surplus, also other few factors, including our rule of law, our information freedom. That's critical for doing business. I hope that our rule of law and the information freedom can be preserved to the extent that the global investors will not be, let's get cold feet and get entering Hong Kong.
Ms. Alvin Jung, Chairman. This is the last time, my last opportunity to speak. I'd like to focus on the issues dearest to the heart of the people of Hong Kong. The funding for the police is something that has aroused a lot of concerns in Hong Kong, and this shows that the government is using some tricks in terms of allocation of funding. The $2.58 billion budget is wholly unacceptable to many people of Hong Kong. We've seen arbitrary arrests, whether it be on the streets or whether it be in shopping malls, or whether it be from the clips provided by private citizens. We've seen that the arbitrary arrest has become uncontrollable, and there is a 25% increase in the budget, and the establishment will see an increase of 2,542, and this is the most unpopular department and most detested department. We see such a sharp increase in the establishment. How can the government convince the people of Hong Kong that the budget is people-oriented? It is well worth supporting. One of the five demands, the Commission of Inquiry, is nowhere in sight. The IPCC report, which is a show, Mr. Anthony Noor, I couldn't even answer how many pages there are in the report. What did KLM say? She said that she would enhance the function of the IPCC. Has she been true to her words? The budget for the IPCC has seen a decrease of 4.4%. The IPCC, which is monitoring the government, cannot compare with the police in terms of the budget. The taxpayers are contributing to the coffers. $2.58 billion is used to buy rubber bullet, tear gas, and water cannon. RTHK, the Observatory, Fire Service Department, these three most trusted departments. And we do need to be grateful to these departments. The budget put together is sort of one-third of what the police are getting. RTHK, what's happening to RTHK, Chairman? The RTHK is being evicted. Who's the landlord? The Hong Kong SAR government. They satirized Carrie Lam, and they put a question to the WHO, and the official couldn't answer the question. And RTHK faces the prospect of being evicted by the SAR government. The production studio will be taken back, and they will have to squeeze in the existing broadcasting house to produce the programs on a 24-hour basis. Well, there is an idiom in Chinese that parents tend to discipline their kids behind closed doors. Now, it is the other way around. They are disciplining their children with the doors wide open. They don't care being seen disciplining the children in public. RTHK observes impartiality and in editorial independence has been producing good programs. What is the SL government dealing with this department? The new broadcasting house is being criticized for too expensive, and they are taking back the premises as the way to deal with the department. The budget has been decreasing over the past 3 years. At the end of the day, is the government trying to get rid of RTHK? If you say that it's not an attempt to dry up the resources of RTHK, what is? During the Special Finance Committee, I have put in written questions to the police. Other than the funding from the budget, is there any other way they can get funding from the public coffers? Indeed, there is. There are ways the electrical cannot monitor. And through these channels, they can get a lot of public money in a secret manner. As I said, under the Public Finance Ordinance 8.3, the FS can use the power conferred upon him by the FS. They can bypass the LegCo without any scrutiny. He can earmark funding to different departments. 1920 financial year, for example, the FS used this power and earmarked $3.09 billion to the police department. 1819 financial year, the FS used this power to earmark $650 million to the police. 1920, compared with the previous year, the police surreptitiously got five times more taxpayers' money. The FS used this power, earmarked $3.1 billion, $2 billion actually belonged to the overtime pay for the officers. It was said that 13,000 officers did get the overtime pay to the tune of $2.5 billion. At the present moment, we don't have any public information to prove that this $2.5 billion worth of overtime pay is part of the $2 billion secretly approved. But we can say logically that we are criticizing this OT payment being a bottomless pit, and they break the law, and they beat up people, and they get overtime pay. What is more ridiculous is that the FS said that whatever the amount of overtime pay, this can be paid for from the taxpayers' money. The trouble is this council cannot probe the details. We cannot raise an objection at all. The police is having such a big budget with a lot of expenditure, and they can actually make up for the deficiencies using their own budget. In the quarterly report, we can see that in 1920 financial year, Q3, they did use the emolument vote to make up for the payment of the police pay. The FS, without asking the LegCo, did secretly approve so much money to the police. What is more suspicious is that this secretive move is an attempt to hide public scrutiny. Also, during the last financial year, the FS also used the power to change the 340 posts in the establishment. If you take this together with the quarterly report, 50 of them are actually new posts. We do have strong reason to believe that of these 348 posts, a lot of them did not go through the Legislative Council. What is of concern is that there is some environment between departments under the Public Finance Ordinance 10.4. The controlling officer of the department can sign a warrant to via the funding from one department to another. The ceiling is $10 million under the warrant, but how many warrants can be signed per year? There is no limit, no ceiling to it. They can sign 10 warrants of $10 million. It can be $100 million. And procedurally, it is okay, and LegCo cannot scrutinize all the details. Neither would the public be aware of it. I've asked the police through various channels for 1920 financial year, are there any other departments that have signed warrant to pass fund to the police, and how many times and how much? They refused to answer my question. Is there any department that has signed any warrant to them and how much was involved. The police, the government refused to answer. Within a year, the police got $330 million, and three or four times than the previous years. According to the Security Bureau, the warrant signed for the police is mainly used for security reasons, like the procurement of the security services from the police. Chairman, I think there is some suspicion, logically. Why is it that if they want to buy the Mills barrier, they have to go through the police? Now, let's say facial masks, it would be the logistics department that would be calling tender and make the procurement. Why is it the police would have to do something that would otherwise don't have to do? What is even more suspicious is that take electrical, for instance, we can see so many water barriers, and they are written in Chinese and English. The word police is in Chinese and English. These water barriers should be funded by individual departments, but the water barriers would become a part of the police's assets. Why is it that the police did not procure the barriers themselves? Why is it that they have to ask departments to put money together to buy them? Chairman, if we want to speculate whether someone's pocketing money, it would be going over the top. But the whole thing is illogical. To cite Mr. Jeremy Tam at the Special Finance Committee, it would be like collecting protection money. The departments will have to hand over money in order to get the protection. Is it really the case? I hope I am wrong. I don't really want to think along this line. But we have earmarked the funding to the police every single year for them to maintain law and order in Hong Kong. Why is it that now we have to bear in mind that other departments, when they need protection from the police, they have to collect money for the water barriers to be provided, and this is something that is filling us with worries, and this is wholly illogical. Chairman, when the pro-establishment members wanted to support this budget, did they ever think that they are taken for the ride by the government? Why did they have to support this detested budget? Many people need the $10,000. Hong Kong has to be relaunched. Even if we vote down the budget, the FS can still, without asking LegCo, devote billions and billions of dollars to the police. There is no problem with how big the establishment is. Now, of course, the police would like to have more, but if the smart pro-establishment members, they should have supported our amendments. Of course, they have voted against, they have an expressed objection to these. If they blindly support this budget, and there are so many controversies involved, and they will be accompanying Carrie Lam in her demise. I think they are trying to get on the sinking boat of Carrie Lam's. Remember the reporter not so long ago? It is the same as this one. Will Beijing be thankful to you? Beijing will only be demanding, issuing demands for you to do what they want you to do. And I hope that the pro-establishment members who are here or not here will think twice about it when you put this to the vote. I hope that you will think twice on how you're going to put this to the vote. The civic party in the debate, in the voting, we will be voting against.
Mr. Tommy Jiang, Mr. Chairman, I speak on behalf of the Liberal Party. I would like to say that we support the passage of the Appropriation Bill 2020. On this occasion, we have got 21 initiatives that came from the Liberal Party and taken on board by the government. On behalf of the Liberal Party, I would like to thank the government. First of all, 100% guarantee product. It is going to help the SMEs in relation to their cash flow. It is going to be very useful. And in fact, the cap has been enhanced to $4 million for the first 12 months. You can just repay the interest, but not the capital, the principal. You can use the money to pay rent or salary. I'll urge the banks not to demand overly complicated documents. Just follow the advice of the Hong Kong Mortgage Corporation and grant the loan and then help the SMEs to survive the hardship. A 100% guarantee product is highly popular. I hope that the government won't stop once the threshold of $50 billion is reached. If it is popular, please go back to the Finance Committee to get more money to help the needy SMEs. Of course, I'm grateful to the FS in relation to the 100% guarantee product. Instead of just covering the micro and SMEs, even listed companies can apply. As long as the major shareholders are willing to sign the application form, it will be considered. I'm grateful. And then the $10,000 cash handout to Hong Kong permanent residents age 18 or above. The Liberal Party is the first political party to make this proposal. Some political parties wondered whether we were asking for too much and whether it was realistic. A political party also suggested that we should come up with consumption vouchers. But in fact, back in 2008, when we had the financial crisis, the financial tsunami, Vincent Fang and myself went to Taiwan to have a look at the distribution of consumption vouchers by their government. We did make a similar proposal to see if that can be useful in riding out the storm. The then FS dismissed the idea, saying that the administrative cost would be too much and the time taken would be too long. The idea was abandoned, and then $6,000 in cash were handed out instead. Now on this occasion, we suggested $10,000. The idea was accepted by the FS. I think both the business sector as well as the general public are looking forward to it. We've been fighting the epidemic for 6 months. We hope the epidemic can come under control so that we can go out to do shopping, to have meals together. The catering industry really needs more customers. We hope that in July we can have the $10,000 cash out. I've always been asking people to stay in Hong Kong to spend the money. Unfortunately, on this occasion, there's no need for me to appeal to the public to stay in Hong Kong. Even if people want to go out, I don't think we will be welcomed and we would be subject to quarantines. We have had the Anti-Epidemic Fund 2.0. Having looked at all the initiatives, we are trying to see what can be done with the $10 billion, $70 billion provided by the government. We would like to have some multiplying effects so that different sectors, different industries can benefit. And we try to see if we can find new opportunities while some other businesses will lose out in the situation. We hope that the $70 billion can be useful in revitalizing the economy. During the SARS outbreak, we counted on visitors to come to stimulate the economy. On this occasion, I don't think we can count on that. So we need to rely on domestic consumption. So probably we need to find ways to make good use of the $70 billion. Other than the $70 billion, I hope the government will come up with more measures to encourage the citizens to spend the money locally so as to stimulate the economy, which is in a doldrum. Mr. Chairman, a moment ago I was upstairs, and that's why I'm still gasping for breath. A few months ago, we were begging the CE, we were begging the FS to include bakeries in the first round of the anti-epidemic fund. The CE at that time said that no, their business didn't suffer. Now, whenever there is a summer holiday, when students don't go to school, business for bakeries will fall. So when classes are suspended at the moment, bakeries are suffering. Maybe it has never occurred to you that for bakeries with a shop at the front, with a kitchen at the back, as well as small bakeries in shopping malls of the link grid, are suffering so drastically. When people don't go to school, it seems that they don't want to buy bread as well. Now, of course, I have to talk about the tax concessions. The cap is now $20,000. The entire amount can be waived as far as the sales tax and profits tax, etc. I made the same point during the resumption of the second reading debate. That is, I think it would be good if you can waive the rates as well, with the cap pitch at $20,000 to $30,000, or we can sort of have all the rates being waived altogether. That would be best. And then there are also ways to help businesses to cut costs. So I'm grateful to the government for extending the concessions in relation to water bills, sewage charges, and electricity subsidies. The COB came up with a program, and last year with my lobbying, and I begged and persuaded them to introduce the subsidy scheme. And in fact, this year, the COP is going to repeat the same program for May, June, and July. And then for the annual returns on the part of the companies, again, the government is introducing a concession. I think it will be a very welcome move. The government has also taken the lead to cut rent for 6 months, and then cruise lines and operators are given concessions for 6 months. Local recycling industry has also got a rental assistance. Rent accounts for a huge part of the business cost, and for many years we have been facilitating the handsome profits of the landlords. Now, I think landlords should follow the lead of the government to cut rent. I said that we should have at least a 50% rent cut for them 3 months starting from April. Finally, I want to say that the FS wasn't present when we had the second reading debate. Now he's also absent, but I hope that he will get it from us and somebody will tell him. That is, the FS should be more forward-looking, should be bolder. He should introduce more initiatives to revitalize the economy. After we have brought the outbreak under control, more should be done. I promise the FS we are going to work hard to generate more than $300 billion by way of profits or tax, etc., for the public coffers. Thank you.
Virginia's Ho. Chairman, I speak to support the Clause 1 and 2 stand part of the bill in this joint debate. And we can see the total appropriation stand at $602.3 billion. On the first part of the debate back on the 6th of May, I stated that Hong Kong has quite a deep reserve. While the rest of the world in deep water, we still have this strength. That speaks something about us. So we are really reaping the fruits sowed by the early generations. However, we can't expect this good time to last forever. So, having enjoyed the blessings, we shouldn't be criticizing half the time. We also have to show appreciation. Well, the money we're getting today are not our own, but rather the fruits of many other people that pile up to become such a deep reserve. Well, back in 1997, or even earlier, for the Rose Park project, with the Hong Kong airport spent over $200 billion, and we were worried about we may run out of money. And Hong Kong people didn't let ourselves down. We keep striving, going upward in adverse times. Well, the $200 billion back then was a very colossal sum. Well, relatively, this amount isn't as much as it were. Well, these all money we have to spend within our means. Well, the $200 billion expenditure at the beginning of the unification, and now the budget have blown up to $627.3 billion, a threefold increase. Our government is far from perfect and being blasted every day. Like in the case of Ocean Park, should we just let go? We can't stop nature. If you can't be fixed, just let them go. You just can't hug the dolphins forever. We should just release them back to the wild. We have to move with the times and also with the circumstances. We shouldn't try to cling on to the old. Out of the $600 billion of expenditure, why our budget have increased by one-third from last year? Well, three big reasons. First, Hong Kong independence. Two, the virus. That all these sectors are in deep turmoil. In this case, the government is not going to sit on their hands. Well, anyone with the right senses should try to come up with solutions to provide imminent relief. So just only 3 weeks. Well, the 599C will be invoked. And also the social distancing managed to cut off the community transmission chain. So we come with the new regulations within 3 weeks. And in just 4 weeks, we're allocating $280 billion for. That's amazing efficiency. Of course, the US also take drastic measures of the $2 trillion plan. However, we don't print money ourselves. We actually deck up our reserves from our annual GDP. In the US, there is simply fiat money. They're using the apprentice. They doesn't have any cost. So maybe just a cost a few cents per banknote. What does it tell you? So we do have the means to pay for this appropriation bill. I see this as a blessing. Some may say that I would not vote for it. First, they don't make the money. Two, they had a part to smash it up Hong Kong. And third, even today, I would not be responsible for the damages. However, I would not care if you want to patch things up. That's the mindset of those advocating independence. Well, because if I don't put you to death, how can you overcome you? Because all they want to think about is to offer your dead body so that you will never rise again and disappeared forever. And they will sing glory to Hong Kong while stamping on your cold, stiffened, and decomposing body. Of the proposed expenditure, even though I support this, I have quite a few unique viewpoints. First, for the major expenditure heads, education, and also the funding for universities to over 100 billion. Healthcare, about close to $100 billion. Social welfare, close to 100 billion. These three expenditure heads made up of 43% of the total appropriation. And those criticize the government as heartless but fail to look at the numbers, and criticizing the government as incompetent, but they're not doing any better. So they're incapable for the task and couldn't be held accountable and wouldn't do the heavy lifting. However, if you want to organize a riot, and they will be the first one coming out. Well, last year, protests cost Hong Kong $1.7 billion. That's the cost of repairs. The financial secretary tells us in the first quarter, our GDP has slid a further 8.9%. Well, to our 2.9 trillion GDP, how much is that to a quarter? That's about 700 billion. That's 9%. Let's call it round up to 9%. That's $63 billion. Well, $63 billion together with this $1.7 billion. Well, I wouldn't put the entire price tag of $68 billion on the independent advocates. Well, they claim that recover Hong Kong until black and criticizing the mainlander for coming to Hong Kong. Well, now they're not coming to Hong Kong. Let's see where they could help make this $2 trillion. Maybe Dennis Kuo would make a few more trips to Washington, D.C. if the flights are resumed, and ask Donald Trump can spare a few crumbs from the $2 trillion GDP. Yesterday, Dennis Kuo was blasting the president and claiming his remarks is relevant. His arrogance, I've yet to figure it out. He's still the representative for the legal constituency. So what regard does it have for the law? And what does he see the rules for? So these three items cost about $300 billion. So where did we find all this money? To pay for all this, I've been feeling quite perplexed. Well, however, we need to act quick. There are a lot of mouths to feed, but not making that much money. What happened to our tax base? It was so narrow. That's why we heard from Mr. Kent Leung. Our effective tax rate is too low. That will be under pressure in the OECD and the G20 group. Our standard tax rate is all at 9% and others were 12.5%. And you can see there's a 3.5% gap. And they will target us. I agree. Well, all law, we only rely on the low tax rate and a narrow tax base. I feel is absolutely outdated. we need to add more taxes. Well, for 12.5%, so maybe not all the way to 12.5. Well, for 9.5 to, let's say, to 2% more, our standard tax rate is 16.5%. So 15% will be for individuals. Well, what's wrong with adding another 2%? Well, you'd worry about not making money. Well, Macau has a high gambling tax. Well, so long you can make money, it doesn't really matter. And even if you issue a few more gambling licenses, it's not about the tax rate, but asking you whether you have the capability and the opportunities that qualify for the tax rate. So to widen our tax rate and raising our taxes, I would say never say never. And also, who is the MPF to serve? The big corporations? That's $800 and $900 billion a year. I had the same position with Paul Chair. For the savings we put aside, when we get this 65, each one only entitled to about $200 and $300 billion. That doesn't amount much. Why don't we live the moment? We can energize, rejuvenate our MPF accounts. An uncle told me, juniors, health is something you seek while you're healthy, not after you lost it. And our MPF contributions should offer immediate relief. I advocated that it should be energized. Some of them can be used for buying property. Some may claim it's too little. How about for insurance premium? Healthcare insurance. So we have another option so that we take our pressure off the healthcare system and you claim. Well, Sophia Chen claims that I'm offering you tax concessions. You just don't get what the public wants. Well, you're only offering quite a few percent and tax concessions is not appealing. However, that money has been sitting in the bank. How you wouldn't allow me to put my hands on it. If I can take $20,000 to pay for the health insurance, I could start planning for my health. Well, something as basic, the government officials have failed to grasp the public mentality. Well, are you doing it for HSBC or the fund managers? Well, they have the $100 billion and speculate in the market and they would lost money to just say sorry. Well, I just blame it on the external market. They claim they minimized the risk and yet they still lost money. Well, so it's not my fault. And they just walk away. And now you're left holding the bag. So why don't we just rejuvenate the MPF? You had refused to listen all along. You claim it's difficult to create new land. So why are you bullying the country, the rural side? And for land resumption, you wouldn't offer $1,000 per square foot and you claim classified the class A, B, C, D. And actually you're paying half of $500 per square foot. And yet the flats were sold multi times over. So when you build, you still same land for housing, you're costing a few thousand dollars per square foot. Well, this is an unfair policy. Well, we're supporting this expenditure of $627.3 billion. It had my total support. However, to cut expenses and boost our revenue, we shouldn't just rely on our inherent strength, but lacking innovation. We need to have more commitment and courage. Well, 23 years on, you still yet to enact the national security laws. Why? Do it right away. I so submit. Thank you.
Mr. Roy Kwong, Chairman. We continue with the scrutiny of the Appropriation Bill 2020. I'd like to say something for the RTHK. There is no funding for education TV. In September, the Education Bureau will be taken taking back the ETV center, and the staff will have to move out as a measure of urgency. If you don't want to become a scrupulous landlord and evict the tenant, you shouldn't do so. Honestly, are you trying to dry up the resources of RTHK? It's plain for everybody to see. Back to the budget. There is one thing I'd like to say, is the budget looking after the old and infirm. The OALA is $3,580. In Macau, they are getting $9,000. The elderly population in Hong Kong, they get only $3,585. But what about those who are scavengers and they are living rough on the street? They don't know how to make the application. For rental housing, there are a quarter of a million people waiting. It is a 5.4 years waiting time. According to the Census and Statistics Department, subdivided units, there are 90,000 SDU households, 200,000 people are living there, and the per capita area is 50 square meters. It's far smaller than the PRH, but the rent is $5,000 or $6,000, or half of the household income. They are living in poverty, and this is a miserable situation, and also young people. In 1997, the starting point for graduates is $14,000. 2019, it is $14,000. And in over the years, there hasn't been any increase. What prospect is holding out for the young people? Chairman, the per capita income in Hong Kong, I hardly talk about this. Now, we normally talk about median income. Now, what is the per capita income in Hong Kong? It is $327,000. If you take all the pay and divide it up, it is so much. And you know how much the highest pay is getting and the lowest pay is getting. So the Gini coefficient is standing on the high side. Median income is $17,000. In Hong Kong, for 10 consecutive years, the property prices have become the highest, most unaffordable. In Q3 last year, the median property prices is $7.4 million, and the per capita income is $327,000. We have to stop eating and drinking for 20 years before we can get on the housing ladder. Chairman, it is difficult for people to start their family. It is even more difficult for people to start talking about having a nice place to live in. The budget should be redistributing the resources. We shouldn't be biased in favor of the well-off. We haven't seen the government doing anything to help the grassroots. The government hasn't done anything to help the poor. Over the years, the government is sitting on colossal reserves. The middle class and the grassroots are having a hard time. And MPF, this is a fund that people are made to contribute into. People are making a pittance. And every time they get paid, they get robbed part of the pay. The workers are unhappy. The employers are unhappy. The fund managers are the happiest. For the MPF, the fund is $969 million, and the management cost is 1.9%, and this is $14.1 billion, the highest over the years. What about the working population? In 2020 Q1, the per capita MPF, they lose $26,000. So this is the most detested MPF, the management fund, management fee is so high, and that people have to suffer from the losses and have to be waiting for many, many years before they get the entitlement, given the high property prices and the stagnant starting pay and also the MPF forced payment. How can Hong Kong people be happy? Hong Kong is a marvelous city. Most of the wealth has gone to the infrastructure, 160 Lianjiayi, 8.1 billion dollars of run for the Kai Tak Stadium. We have been throwing good money after bad, and this is hard-earned money we have. We work so hard, and you're robbing us of the money in terms of MPF payment. Why is it that overrun, cost overruns have become the new normal? Have you seen so many before? 1989, David Wilson, Governor David Wilson, talked about the Rose Garden, one of the 10 core programs, including the Chatham Kok Airport. 1992, let's go, earmarked $160 million, and the bill ended up being $150 billion, and they got some money back, $8.4 billion back. This is wholly preposterous. We cannot sit idly by. Since when have you chalked up so much cost overruns? SCL, they are getting $10 billion for cost overruns, $600 billion is for the POC. Over the past couple of weeks in the budget debate, we are talking about a lot of grassroots people who are looking at the budget and cannot get anything at all from it. And there are people who are suffering in a very dire situation. But the senior top-notch officials, how much are they getting paid? They're getting paid $10,000 per day. And people have to work a whole month before they can get this much. For if they get the opportunity to change anything, it is the budget that they can do it. They are just staying in a rut. The only thing that the only highlight this year is the $10,000 cash handout, but a lot of money is going to the administrative fees, and this is leaving me fuming. It at the CSA stage, we are before we comment on the merits of the budget, we have to ask what function is there for the budget. If we can get back all the cost overruns and spend the money on public housing, hospitals, schools, for the grassroots, for the elderly population, for the universal retirement protection, it would be a good idea. Why is it not possible? Why do you have to benefit the fund houses? Why do you have to throw good money after bad and plow money into these infrastructural projects? Why do you have to be biased in favor of the wealth and the powerful? Chairman, the former president, John Kennedy, said that if we cannot look after the poor in a society, we cannot look after the handful of the rich either. So given the disparity in wealth, why is it that we do not allow an opportunity to change in the budget? Why do you have to give petty favors to the grassroots people? And you're spending billions and billions of dollars. There is only pittance, there are only crumbs left over for the grassroots people. This trickle-down effect, I don't buy it. What we can see is 1 million or so poor people in our midst. They are stubborn. They shouldn't be living in poverty in a wealthy society like Hong Kong, simple as that. Chairman, with these words, I conclude my speech.
Does any other member wish to speak? Mr. Holden Chong. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I've been listening to Mr. Roy Kwong's speech. He talked about the fiscal philosophy. For today's budget, I just want to give some supplementary remarks in the light of what he said. He talked about the cost overrun of projects as well as other arrangements, so that some mega projects have incurred cost overruns. Of course, the matter should be taken seriously, and I hope that in a moment, the public officers can clarify the position. What we are asking the government to do is that, in fact, it has come up with a project cost control office. In theory, this office should play this role in the project management. From step 0 to step 100, the project cost control office should have a monitoring role so as to control the cost. We have a similar setup in England. At FC meetings and on other occasions, I did mention that I had high hopes of the Project Cost Control Office. I hope it can effectively play its monitoring role. I hope the office will get the same powers as those given to the Ombudsman. Without such powers, even if you discover that civil servants or project teams have committed mistakes, or they are negligent, or there are irregularities, there will be powers available to check and balance and to penalize those who are in the wrong. So I think the Project Cost Control Office in the long run should be given similar powers. Otherwise, we cannot effectively control the project cost. So I hope the administration will get this from me and agree with us. As I have said, probably the highlight of this year's budget is the cash handout of $10,000. The crucial point is the speedy distribution of the cash handout. Today, if we are able to pass the bill, I will urge the administration to hand out the money as soon as possible. How? I think many citizens are already drawing social benefits or other sorts of allowances or subsidies. Then please make use of such accounts to hand out the money. Well, for a long period of time, the government was criticized for being very, very slow when it came to the distribution of subsidies or cash handouts, because the government has not made up its mind and hasn't got the will to set up a central database. In fact, I think the budget this year should set aside money to set up a proper central database. Now, it isn't just for the sake of the cash handout of $10,000 on this occasion. In future, when we provide social security, we can work through the same database. In this way, you don't have to set up a new system every time you introduce a new program. Even though you may say that online registration will be easy and speedy, but it can never beat the speed coming out from a central database. You set up a system last time you handed out $6,000, but then there was privacy concerns, and probably you thought that it would be a breach of the privacy regulations if you were to use the same data from last time. But to me, it is not efficient. You spend so much money to set up the system, and yet it is just for one-off arrangements, then it will be hugely problematic. So I hope that in a moment, when public officers give a reply, will be given a clear signal. That is, upon passage of the bill, what are you going to do? Are you going to set up a central database? are you going to make up your mind to introduce such a system? Of course, I'm not asking for this central database to be set up overnight, but take this opportunity of $10,000 cash handout to put together such a system. I think the government owes us an explanation or an undertaking. Now back to another point. Some members who spoke talked about the function of the budget in the distribution or redistribution of wealth and income. The government used to uphold the idea of small government, big market, and non-interventionist, especially positive non-intervention. But then the wealth gap is being aggravated. So I think the government should rightly intervene. Had it not been for this epidemic, I think the government would not be so bold in giving out such an amount of subsidies. I believe that within the government, for being so generous about the welfare benefits, the government has always been sort of reluctant to do so. But as a result of the epidemic, the government eventually decided to do so. On different occasions, we put this question to the FS, and he gave us an answer. That is, today we are going to spend such a huge amount of money, and probably we are going to incur a huge deficit. But then let's hope that it is not going to be a long-term structural deficit. It is good, it is important to see that he has this will to take this very bold step to break out of the former way of thinking. Now, the economy was hard hit. For 6 months, we have had the black riots, and then we are getting this crisis as a result of the epidemic. I think that's the background of having such tremendous help from the government physically. We need to make it clear. We don't expect it to be done on a long-term basis. If this is going to be sort of a standing arrangement, this is going to give us a structural fiscal deficit. It's not healthy. But still, I'll urge the government to consider the following. That is, for a way forward, if we're able to salvage the economy of Hong Kong, I would urge the government to reconsider our taxation policies as well as our welfare policies. I hope you will have some new ideas. For the cash handout, yes, it is universal. Everybody is getting $10,000. For the anti-epidemic fund, I understand that you have studied the characteristics of individual sectors or industries before you draw up the programs to help them. Now, I'll urge the government to take a forward step. We have many freelancers. For one reason or other, they haven't contributed to any MPF accounts, or they are not sort of recognizable as participants of any sector or business. So even if the government would like to help them, even if the government would like to give them some subsidies, as it is not easy to verify the status, the government is not willing to hand out any subsidies to them. But I have to say that this is a very rigid way of thinking. Well, with this epidemic, I think it is time for us to devise a system so that you can tell whether somebody is a participant in a particular sector of business. And then in future, if the government would like to help a particular sector of business, then there's an easier way to verify the applicants. Let me cite an example. Liang Jiechang and myself were aware that the government would like to give a subsidy to the tutorial schools. But what about people who are music teachers or people running interest classes? But they cannot be verified. There's no need for them to take out a license, so there's no way to prove that they have been in the sector. And as a result, $40,000 can be claimed by a licensed tutorial school, but not teachers who are who have been teaching music or ballet, etc. And then for the movie industry, we did take up the matter with the Commerce and Economic Development Bureau. There are actors and actresses who haven't got any registration with anybody, and they found it difficult to prove their status. So I think it's high time for us to come up with a system so that people can easily prove their credentials. I think the government is duty bound to devise a system to do so. Well, I think it is a lesson that we should learn from this epidemic. Now, strictly speaking, the anti-epidemic fund isn't part of the budget, but I believe that the appropriate officers who are in attendance here will take on board my concern, and when they give a reply in a moment, they will specifically tell us what they are going to do. There are gaps that we have identified, and you need to spend time and effort to close the gaps. Well, everybody knows that we are in a very dire situation. Everybody would like to receive their $10,000 as soon as possible. The FS told us that even with the passage of the appropriation bill, it will be end of June that we get the money. It would be too late, too slow. Somehow, some citizens have not benefited from anything under the AEF. They barely need the $10,000. So I urge you to expedite the processing of the applications. Just now, someone told me that having listened to my first speech, while we support the passage of the bill, and it's all because we hope that the government won't be brought to a standstill, and we don't favor the scorched earth policy, and we hope that the $10,000 can be handed out ASAP. We are not at the same time saying that we are happy with the performance with all the government departments. I believe that many of my colleagues from the pro-establishment camp, would share my view. We don't want to have a scorched earth policy. We want to pass the appropriation bill to benefit everybody. But still, it doesn't mean that we don't find, we find that some government departments need to improve their performance. But that won't be the argument to back up the idea to cut the expenditure of specific departments, like what the opposition camp has been seeking to do, that is to cut the expenditure of the police force. We can never agree with them. The police force have been under great pressure. Policemen risked their lives when they were on duty. So how come that they would like to cut the expenditure? Are you going to ask them to sacrifice their lives because they have the risk of knife attacks as well as petrol bomb attacks? So pass the bill, benefit everybody. Regarding individual departments like the Radio Television Hong Kong, we'll urge the government to tell us about the plan for the future. There are departments that are having problems. You need to rectify the situation. I look forward to a clear reply from the government in a moment. So I spoke. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Now remind members, I will ask the public opposition to reply by 6:30, and then I will vote on the clause individually until we complete the third reading. And members should press the button if they'd like to speak. Chen Chenying, Chairman. In this session, we are members should indicate whether they support the bill as a whole and the joint debate on clause 1 and 2 standing part of the bill. I agree with the appropriation arrangements. Like in my previous two rounds, first, I would like to speak on the $10,000 handout scheme. Back in 2011, when we have the first handout of $6,000, mainly through the bank account transfer, even though the public would need to queue at the banks, but the overall arrangement is smooth. However, for the $4,000 by the CCF, there were chaos. As a smart city, we can deploy cashless electronic payment in our daily transactions, but for the handout plan, the government have not conveyed whether they would deploy any innovative ways in place of conventional ways. The errors claim that they will still require registration whether online or by paper. I felt that the government did not think it through. Most infuriating is that in my first round, I stated, I raised it with my colleagues that whether for this time that we can provide the payments of the over 1 million households that we can directly credit it to the accounts of the social welfare payments holders. In earlier debates, and secretary law had resorted to various excuses in rejecting it. Well, first he claimed privacy concerns. He claimed that the over 1 million households or this population strong might not be willing to provide the same information to get the amount. And I find out from the privacy commissioner that so long there were no complaints, it shouldn't be a problem. And the secretary of law later provided a second excuse and claimed there are different welfare systems running in parallel, which require system testing. And the testing capability is limited, thus we're not able to have another system so as to add to the risk. I find it unacceptable. For commercial organizations, we have 3 to 4 systems being tested together. However, if we have something of a high priority, I believe that we have set up a special task force to see through the project. And just because we have 2 or 3 systems in the testing phase, I couldn't be preempted by another more important project. If we able to register this time for future handout schemes, for example, we can have consumption vouchers. Our economy could not recover. Would you have another round of handouts to $3,000 to $4,000? So I hope that you don't have to register every time for a new handout. So let's say we can have the consent clauses in the registration form so that they will still be eligible for future payments automatically. And I found it's a no. Well, they have looked into that, but I have no idea why there are a lot of lawyers have looked into it and found it's unworkable. No matter how you phrase it, they're not able to meet the legal requirements. That's quite baffling. Maybe I've been working so long in a private company. I suppose you have put more minds together that this has actually been resolved. But as of this moment, even though we've known about the details of the registration and the form, first of all, I know that this is still a one-off arrangement. So either you fill out the form online or for a hard copy, it's really for the single purpose of $10,000. If the government plans to have future cash disbursement, well, sorry, you have to register again. Well, Chairman, this is beyond my understanding. To resolve this, we require all departments and lawyers and experts to set aside your bureaucracy and really adopt the public feeling mentality. If you are determined of what most obstacle could be overcome. If we have similar arrangements in the future, I believe the focus will be providing the most convenient way to disperse the cash. The banks are willing to work with you. However, our processing time, our capability, are not as quick if it is done fully electronic. On my second point, in this appropriation bill, we see the government had drummed up the courage to help the public to ride out the storm. And like Mr. Kent Leung said, that our public finance philosophy should be reviewed and reflected. Well, we have a lot of shortcomings in our fiscal policy, and these shortcomings could not easily rectify. First is our narrow tax base, and second, our reliance on land revenue. Well, our tax base is such a state that over 50% of the working population do not pay any salary taxes, while the salary taxes only concentrate on the top few percent of the taxpayers, made up of 63% of the total income tax receipts, salary tax receipt. And all the registered company, over 90% of the company, do not pay any profit tax. And those who need to pay profit tax, 5% of the tax receipt made up 90% of the whole tax receipt. Such high concentration will affect our taxation policy. Well, nobody offers a good solution. If you introduce new taxes, well, that could be politically sensitive. If you rest on your hands in changing our tax base, it's difficult to cope with this ever-rising expenditure. Thus, we need to make our mind to tackle this. In terms of our debt, the government carry on a huge debt. One will be our retirees' pensions, as we have a rising wave of retirement. I believe that this debt would rise exponentially. And second, our commitment on a capital works project. Even though past 2 years the approvals slowed down, however, these projects made up a significant chunk of our financial commitment. And thirdly, we failed to calculate our liabilities by the money of the day manner. We all see that future payments maybe is different with discount to current day prices. Well, like Mr. Chu said in the FC meeting, we should come up with ways to show the future commitment into current money price, current day prices. I have raised it many times in the meeting, but the government have failed to take any action to let us know our assets and liability in terms of modern day prices. And third, how do government use their reserve optimally? Well, when economy comes to crisis, that we can take drastic measures in launching the AEF and in this budget to have this cash handout for everyone. And our reserve accumulate scattered in quite a few funds. And 2 years ago, when we first raised the matter, the financial secretary have recruited a group of experts to look into something like a sovereign fund to help better manage our budget. Unfortunately, we haven't seen any proposals on how do we take this forward. And thirdly, to address the potential structural deficit, we need to ensure our future revenue cap is strengthened. The Hong Kong role as an intermediary is important. How do we recruit capital in China and how to attract foreign investment here is important. The FDRC recently issued a report and hope that we can reinforce our role as an offshore RMB hub. I agree with various viewpoints raised in the report, especially they proposed setting up something like a tracker fund but denominated in RMB, which is quite an important proposal to develop offshore RMB business. We used to have a vibrant offshore RMB market, but why would the pool have reached $1 trillion? Because there were expectation of appreciation that's proved to be short-lived. Well, if RMB market was floating, a pool had now decreased to $6 trillion. And how to make our offshore RMB business to grow over time and allow the financial sector to benefit from this? How do we implement the FDSDC proposal in diversify our RMB products and ensure that more choices for RMB products? And on the mutual market access scheme, the FDRC also mentioned on the market access schemes. I always hope for the southbound connect can be open as soon as possible, and I hope that the administration can get on with it soon. In the financial sector, trade volume is important. So long as we can attract different capital to transact in Hong Kong, then we would have a higher survival rate. And next, fintech. I hope that this appropriation bill, well, there's much mentioning of fintech in this bill. Well, maybe in the past 2-3 years they devote certain portion to fintech. However, you have never have too much of fintech. I hope that the FS and the relevant financial officials continue to take note of fintech development and devote more resources. And finally, Chairman, the biggest problem facing Hong Kong is aging demographic. Our population of 7 million, by 2043, it will increase to 8.22 million. By then, the number of seniors, by 2036, it may hit 2.37 million. And all the budget is built on the premises that we have one-third of the population over 65. Thus, a lot of the financial planning should be done early. However, when we get to one-third of the population being 65 plus, the financial difficulty would definitely be manifold compared to now, I so submit.
Ms. Yan Chen. Thank you, Chairman. The budget is supporting jobs, protecting livelihood as the main theme. $120 billion anti-cyclical measures have been rolled out. I'm sure that for the members of the public, the focus of attention is very much on the cash handout of $10,000 for those over the age of 18. When I went shopping, grocery shopping this morning, they asked me why I was so early. I told them I had to go back to the council to debate the budget. Many people didn't understand that they thought that they would get the money once the announcement was made. Now, we are still debating the budget, and I explained to them that I had to join the debate continuously. For these $10,000, this may not mean a lot, and they may be prepared to donate the money. But for those who are in dire straits and during the pandemic period, for those who get virtually nothing, this is rainy day money for them. Since March, April, May, This has not been endorsed. Once endorsement is given, how is it going to be dished out? I know that the FS found it difficult to pen the budget because there were a number of relief measures before the budget. I was wondering what else could the FS do during these exceptional times. I would agree that we adopt exceptional measures to dish out the money to help the people. If we vote in favor of the budget, we would then ask the FS told us, I listened back to his speech, he said that within June registration would take place. By July, August, the money will be going out to the public. People cannot wait until August. They hope that with the passage of the budget, they would see the money quick. The government should do it the way the face masks are dished out. In terms of the speed with which they are dished out and the registration online, the government was in for a lot of praise. I hope that they would consider the same method. Like Mr. Bronick Chan, I cannot accept what the SLW said. Can we allow the CSSA recipients to get the money first? He said no. Under the anti-epidemic fund, there are a lot of registrations. A lot of people have registered themselves. Can they get the money sooner? The answer is no. So what are we doing now? Of those who don't have a personal account, they should open one. The only thing I heard is these kind of remarks. I haven't heard the government trying to use the existing facilities to dish out the money. You can think of some ways to dish out the face masks. Why is it so difficult with the cash handout? I don't want to see this good cause turn out to be a bad thing. As a parent myself, that with the e-cards, we can see how much money should be transferred in terms of payments for books, textbooks, and so on. I hope that with the passage of the budget, the government would heed the voices of the public. At least in the CSSA accounts and also the existing accounts that are known to the government, they should get the money ahead of others. Let me turn now to the middle class. In the budget, there are different measures for different people, but in relation to the middle class, the government has not gone far enough. The budget was delivered in February. The pandemic was raging at the time. If you look back 6 months back, we saw the social movement, a lot of middle-class people were affected, a lot of businessmen were affected in different ways, and they were under pressure. We've been urging the government to adopt a certain measure, they never think out of the box to help the middle class. Say, for instance, the foreign domestic helper tax should be waived. For the middle class, they may be called middle class. They cannot afford the property. They're paying hefty rents. Can we allow certain tax holiday against the rent? The government simply adopts the conventional means. The only highlight is the $10,000 cash handout. The government adopts the conventional ways, the rates waiver. Profit tax rebate and so on. And the middle class are paying tax, but they stand to benefit very little from the government. They stand to benefit from the assistance in a very, very small way. I hope that during this pandemic period, the support for the middle class cannot be forgotten. We have so many official sitting here, except the SEN. Oil prices, you look at last month, it was in the negative territory. One would ask, why is it that oil prices are quick to jump but slow to come down? The government keeps saying that we don't have the oil refineries, and the auto oil is actually an imported product, and the oil companies don't have any collusion. They're not fixing the prices. We asked them to lower the fuel prices, and that would certainly help the middle class. Certain oil companies might offer to give you some two bottles of water or some coupons for free, and there is no reduction in the oil prices. Other than the budget, I'm sure there are other measures that the government can think of. With the passage of the budget, it doesn't mean that the government can grind to a halt in rolling out beneficial measures. The government should offer more in-depth assistance. Given the situation in Hong Kong and also in the region or in Europe and the US, the situation is really dire, and tourism, one of the mainstay of Hong Kong's economy, will not be coming back, and there will not be a lot of tourists coming to Hong Kong. So how can revive the economy? How can make people spend into the economy? $10,000 might help, you may say. Now, after the $10,000, they might not be in the mood to go out and about. And after 23 days streak of no cases, we have seen a locally transmitted case, and there are protests at the shopping malls that turn ugly with the pandemic easing a little bit. On Mother's Day, we saw protests rearing its ugly head. Your question, point of order, Chairman. I think you're applying a different standard. Ms. Yan Chan is not focusing her attention on whether she's supporting the budget. You let her go on like this. My standard is the same if you sit down and listen. Mr. Chu might not have listened to me. I was saying that other than the $10,000, the government should do more to help the middle class. There is not much for the businessmen other than the tax rebate. They find it very difficult to stay in business. The restaurants, I would like to do more business on Mother's Day, and the pandemic is easing a little bit, but they cannot do it. I hope that the government will, with the passage of the budget, redouble the efforts. I dare not say that you should roll out an anti-epidemic fund 3.0, because you are enhancing 2.0 at the moment. We should help, for instance, at the barber shop. Mr. Kwok has made a suggestion for them to be incorporated into the fund. I hope that you would adopt this kind of attitude going forward. Apart from the middle class, I'd like to say something about health care. This is my focus of attention. During the pandemic, health is of paramount importance. What I'm unhappy about is in the budget over the past 2 years, each year there is a $1,000 increase for the medical coupon to $3,000. This year, the budget is completely silent on this $1,000 support for the healthcare voucher scheme for the elderly people. And this has got nothing to do with the FS. It has to do with the Policy Bureau. It's entirely their decision, their judgment call. The voucher scheme will, in a way, promote primary healthcare for the elderly population, the $1,000. Can be used for traditional Chinese medicine. They pay $120 for a session, and also dental care. We don't have any public dental care. With the voucher scheme, they I mean, it cost them $3,000 or more for a false tooth. And with the voucher, they can fix their decaying teeth one by one, and they would expect some prospect of having some teeth instead of being edentulous. We have the secretary here. Each year, the government used to add $1,000 for the health care voucher scheme in 2014 to now 2020. In 2014, I was still a political assistant, and we saw an increase in the voucher scheme. But 6 years on, you have turned a blind eye to this scheme. You pay lip service to respecting the elderly folks, but I don't think you're doing anything in concrete. I hope that we don't have to make such a modest request every time we have the budget cycle. I mentioned dental care. In the medical sector, this is one of the neglected areas. Dental care for the children only cover up to P6. In university, you may have dental clinics. Why is it that there is a gap, there is a missing link somewhere in the middle? It doesn't cost an awful lot of money, but at least the school children, secondary student, university student, they would have a good dental care in the street out there. 10 out of 10 elderly people are edentulous. In the budget in 2021-22, the additional expenditure would be $3.6 billion for the hospital authority to retain the staff. That is $3.6 billion. I hope that the HA will think twice about it. This is not the first time we increased the budget for the healthcare staff. But the turnover rate is exceedingly high. I hope that the HA would put the money to good use. In our public hospitals, why is it that we cannot retain the staff? We keep talking about recruiting overseas doctors as a result of the novel coronavirus. I'm sure it's going to be even more difficult to get anybody from outside. So this funding for retaining staff, I hope that the HA would consider how they can harness the resources of traditional Chinese practitioners who are earning a wage lower than that of a nurse, and this is wholly unreasonable. So with this additional funding, the government should turn the site to the TCMs. Lastly, the young entrepreneurs, the young graduates are likely to be going jobless upon graduation. I hope that in factory buildings, and they should be given opportunity to give full play to their creativity. They can be allowed to try their hands at entrepreneurship as long as they provide them with the venues and some funding. With the passage of the bill, I hope that the government will announce the details regarding the $10,000 cash handout and offer as much support for the middle class, the young people, and the elderly. Thank you.
Ms. Alice Mack. Mr. Chairman, everybody is focusing on the $10,000 cash handout for everybody when it comes to the budget this year. The FS has earmarked a large amount of money, but then the most eye-catching initiatives is the $10,000 cash handout. But please don't expect a round of applause when you give money to somebody, because you never get any applauses for whatever you do. I think you count yourself lucky if you get less lashing out. Just like giving out a face mask, you still get a lot of criticism, like it doesn't look nice, and then there will be leak of privacy, etc. Well, of course, I think they are not going to dismiss it by saying that the money or the banknotes are not good. But then, are they going to advise the comrades not to get the $10,000? For the cash handout, why can't we make it easier? Last time, the handing out of the $4,000 was a total mess. On this occasion, we have expected a simple exercise. The FTU immediately came up with ideas to streamline the procedures. Say, for example, recipients of CSSA, OH living allowance, OH allowance, disability allowance, etc. They have already got their information with you. Can you not sort of pay $10,000 directly into their account while you give them 1 month's extra allowance? Don't forget that we have also got elderly people who are with the Guangdong scheme as well as the Fujian scheme. It's not easy for them to fill out forms. Who's going to help them to fill out the forms? Yes, you talk about online registration, but then they live on the mainland. It's not easy to get somebody to register online for them. When I spoke for the first time, I posed similar questions. Dr. Lo Chi Kwong was in attendance, and he said that it would not be easy for the SWD to do so. It would take a long time. It's most disappointing. We are going to spend so much money, and yet you're telling me that the SWD system can't cope with it. Now, the FS office has tried hard. Mr. Ronica Chen also promised on behalf of the banking industry that they would tie in with the effort. Let's hope that with the passage of the bill today, we can kickstart the system. Now, you are paying 1 month's extra allowance to the recipients. Why can't you also use the same system to give them $10,000? Lo Chi Kwong said that the SWD is already busy. They can't cope with the extra workload. I'm not sure whether you're trying to help the comrades. The comrades are going to say that you should make it easier, and then they're not concerned about privacy. It's mind-boggling. It is mind-boggling for the principal officials that are supposed to be the elites in our society. How come that they don't know what to do so as to resolve the problem? Mr. Chairman, the government did provide a large number of concessionary initiatives on top of the $10,000 cash handout, like the employment support scheme. There are still people who have been left out, especially those who are freelancers. Yes, of course, I know that if you have an MPF account, even though you are self-employed, you'll still be eligible. Mr. Chairman, in Hong Kong, if you want to prove that you have a job and you have an income, surprisingly, you can only rely on an MPF account. Otherwise, it's difficult to verify your employment status. Well, if that is the case, then there is a loophole in our system. FS, you need to carry out a comprehensive review. Be it the ESS or other concessionary measures, you are providing assistance under different headings, programs or funds, but we haven't got a personal account for each and every citizen. So I think we need a proper system so that whether we provide an employment benefit or when we would like to have a cash handout, it will be much simpler, and then there won't be so many hurdles or difficulties. now covered those who haven't got an MPF account. They were left out. Other sectors have also been left out. Over the past few days, I'm getting a large number of telephone calls. Those who are wholesalers don't get anything. Retailers have got a scheme for them, but not so for the wholesalers. Wholesalers, people were deterred from going to shopping malls as a result of the Black Riots, and the riots have been, the violence emerged again. So shopping malls are closing their doors, and so wholesalers don't get any business. Now, somebody who is a shoe wholesaler told me that he's not getting any orders. Now, if the epidemic is still breaking out and people don't want to go to the shopping malls, then wholesalers won't get any business. Of course, I hope that the Black Riots would subside, the epidemic will come under control, and then we can go back to the normal life and we don't need so many different support schemes. But what if the epidemic is still raging and the Black Riots are still with us? We need to think of a way to cover those who have been left out. And then one among many initiatives is the opportunity to defer tax payment. This is a good arrangement. Somebody may be forced to take no pay leave or getting or becoming jobless. It will be difficult to find money to pay tax. What about rent? Not that we are not going to pay the rent after all. It's a matter of whether we will be allowed to defer our rent payment. For the housing department's computer system, the tenant will get an eviction letter if the system tells the department that somebody is in rent arrears. We have this four-person household. The couple worked in the catering industry. Both of them lost their jobs one after another. The sons are at school and they don't have any savings at all. Now they have lost their jobs, they haven't got any income for months. Now, you cannot apply for rent assistance if you have only been allocated a flat for less than 2 years' time. It is a very weird logic. You can't expect anybody who's a new tenant with the housing department that they won't experience financial difficulties. So I just wonder if you can allow the tenants to defer their rent payment if you are already doing so for tax payments. If the tenant can prove that he is out of a job and he has financial difficulty, then why can't you let them defer the rent payment? So I'm asking the government to think from the perspective of the tenants and to do something that is more tenant-friendly. FS, it's good to see you here. We're spending a lot of money on different kinds of projects. We are aware that there will be an economic downturn. We've been dealt the double whammy because of the social unrest as well as the epidemic. There are also other uncertainties in the external environment. Oil prices would be one of the factors. In the past, the oil prices never ventured into the negative territory. Nowadays, that happened, and so there are a large number of uncertainties. We need to be ready to take on the challenges. You need to build in a lot of buffers. I think the consumption pattern will change in the aftermath of the outbreak. In the past, people might not favor deliveries of takeaway food. Nowadays, it is getting more popular. In the past, we never imagined that we could work from home or we could attend a meeting in a remote fashion. Now, everything has been found to be feasible. So we have a large number of unskilled workers who would face uncertainties in their job security. It isn't just a matter of whether we can get a job when the epidemic is under control. There's this question that the economic model will change, the job arrangements will change, and as a result, they may never get back into the labor market again. So FS, I think you need to make preparations for such a change. We need to be ready so that we can face the challenges that are unimaginable today. We will be surprised by many new changes. So FS, I think you need to provide more buffers so that we can take on the challenges. Give us the $10,000 as soon as possible and in as simple ways as possible. We will resume at 5:15.